Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our town hall. My name is Pallavi, and I'm a consultant for the Magic Foundation. Here with me is fellow consultant Megan Huppel, who will be hosting the town hall with me. Before I introduce the speaker, I just want to let you know if you have any questions along the way, type them in the message bar, and Megan will ask those questions on your behalf in the QA segment. I would like to introduce to you now Dr. Manju Dawkins, a board-certified dermatologist who has received her BA from Columbia University and her MD from the University of Maryland. She completed her residency and served as chief resident at Albert Einstein College of Medicine in Bronx, New York. She was assistant professor at Mount Sinai School of Medicine, where she was twice named Teacher of the Year. She has practiced in academic, private, hospital-based, and group practice settings in New York and Los Angeles. And she's also the creator and co-founder of Thimble, the first easy, safe, and comprehensive solution for alleviating needle pain and stress. Over to Dr. Manju.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. It's really such an honor, and I have a feeling that I'm going to learn a lot more from you than I'm going to be able to kind of impart any kind of knowledge, because this is a newer field that we're all kind of learning about together. So I'll just go ahead and start sharing my screen and we'll get started. And I'll just kind of tell you about my why, and then we'll go to questions. Everybody can see it okay?
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, so we're gonna just talk a little bit about how we can alleviate needle fear. You're probably wondering, what is a dermatologist doing talk to me about this? But really, why I got started in it was my own experience with my own daughter. I have two daughters. So to back up, so when I was in my dermatology residency training, I had my first daughter, and she was about a month old, and I brought her in for her first set of vaccines. And I thought, okay, kind of offered her up, like, here you go, very proud of myself. And then, when she got stuck, I was just kind of mortified, because the way she looked at me was just one of like pain, but then also betrayal. Like, how could you let this happen to me? I felt like I didn't protect her. And what strikes me is it was kind of the first moment of broken trust between mother and child, but also the first moment of broken trust between physician and patient. So I think these kind of painful procedures that we put people through really impacts the trust that remains between healthcare people and patients, and also parents and patients. So that's kind of been my motivation. And this is a problem that no one is talking about. I feel it's like the biggest issue that no one even mentions in healthcare. Most kids are just like my daughter, afraid of needles, and no one likes them. But the reality now is that 60% plus of all people in the world have some fear of needles. And there's good reason for this, right? When I was a kid, I got 6 shots before the age of 6. My kids have gotten 36 shots each in that same time, and they don't have any endocrine disorders to deal with. So that's a lot more needles than that people are getting now. And so each of those injections is a moment for potential trauma, right? So that's why I think it's imperative that we start to talk about it and realize that this is a universal issue that basically we're all dealing with, and we need solutions. How are we going to make this better? Because what's happening, it's driving people away from healthcare, right? They're not getting all of the vaccines that they need, or the blood draws that they need, the medication injections. They're not donating blood as much anymore. So there's a real impact that we've got to face. So what the research shows is that pain tends to be the biggest contributor to needle fear, but there is a lot that goes into it. And I think one of the things that's important to recognize is that every person is different. We had one kind of model who had tattoos who had a fear of needles, and there was a lot of pushback, like, oh, she's not afraid of needles, she has tattoos. But that's not fair to say, right? Who are we to judge someone else? And receiving a tattoo has a completely different psychology than someone telling you need to get a vaccine or you're going to get fired, right? So there's a lot that we need to consider. And so I think when it comes to speaking to your child or whoever you're taking care of who has needle fear, I think talking to them about what it is that they need is imperative. Young children know, they know, and we don't give them enough credit, and they can tell us exactly what they need. And for some people, it's not the pain. For some people, it's seeing the needle. For some people, it's the idea of somebody taking blood from you. So we have to really ask people what it is that's bothering them and then address them with the correct solutions. So what can we do? Like, how can we help? Well, what we know so far, because of really fantastic research that was spearheaded actually by a pharmacist in Canada, her name is Dr. Anna Taddeo, and she has an entire team, and I wish I could name everyone, alongside research from a physician here in the US named Dr. Amy Baxter, who invented the buzzy, and I have a feeling that probably a lot of people have heard of her invention. What we know is that a multimodal approach to needle pain and needle fear is what works best. And so, what does that mean? It means one solution alone isn't going to help everyone the same. So we've got to target all of the different angles of needle phobia, needle fear, and use them together, and they're going to work more powerfully. So I'm just going to touch on some of the things that, the research has showed us. And I'm going to kind of talk about it in what do we do to prepare, what do we do during the injection, and what do we do afterwards. So to prepare, the first thing is to just use really honest language. And for people who are doing injections every day, this might not be so much of an issue for you. But it was interesting when we were just talking before this talk started, when the injections went from daily to every 3 months, the fear built up over that 3 month period of time. And that's when talking about it very honestly can be important again. I think what has happened, over the years, there are all these injections. And, another kind of driver for me to start this was that, as a healthcare professional, you just get less and less time with patients, and you don't have the ability to kind of really create an empathic relationship as much anymore. And that's what's missing, and that's what makes the honestly the pain of all of the procedures that we do worse, I think. So let's go back. So be honest, talk about what's really happening. Don't minimize. Don't say this isn't going to hurt at all. No one likes to be lied to. Be honest, and then move forward. Make a plan. So that means make a plan together. So talk to your child, whoever you're taking care of, about what it is they need and what they want. And sometimes it might be a little extra time. And going back to my own example, being in, as a clinician, you don't have a lot of time. And you as a parent, you don't have a lot of time. You got all these things to do and you got to go. But then what happens is the humanity gets sucked out of the whole interaction, right? But we have to remember there's a human being in front of us that has needs and feelings and all of these things. What is it that you need? Simply being present with the person, just being aware of, their humanity helps the pain in and of itself. So it's really, really, really important. And then prep the skin. So I wish everybody knew about knew about these solutions because so many people are suffering. But I think a lot of you know about Emla. So Emla is a prescription numbing cream that you apply roughly 2 hours before any needle procedure. And so I want you to talk to your own kind of physicians about this, but you simply apply a big glob of cream. So it's not like a sunscreen where you have to rub it in. No, it's a big glob of the medication. You need to occlude it with something like Saran wrap or a Tegaderm, and ideally leave it in place for a couple hours, right? It doesn't work very quickly, but it does work. And the key is to kind of keep the medicine in the right place. You can mark the area that you're going to be using it for, and then go ahead with the injection. For people whose main issue is pain, I feel that this is really, really important. I use it with my own children, and I think it's been a game changer. There are some inconveniences about it, right? It does require a prescription, so you have to, have a prescriber who believes that this kind of pain is worth treating, and I think there are more and more of us out there. And there are some side effects that you need to talk about, like the risk of methemoglobinemia and other things. Full disclosure, My company is called Thimble, and we make solutions for needle pain, and we try to go through all the points of pain and all the drivers of the fear. So we've also developed a pre-procedure patch that can be applied beforehand. It's applied an hour before, so we're trying to lessen the time, and it's a drug and adhesive patch, so it looks like a sticker. So we're trying to make it a little bit easier for people and trying to make it more accessible so that you don't have to necessarily go get a prescription. Okay, so let's talk about, oops, sorry, during. So there's a lot here, what we can do. And again, this is where you need to talk to your child or your patient. I just want to mention another solution that is handy for the during part, and that's the buzzy, which again was invented by Dr. Amy Baxter. So that is a tool that uses vibration and cooling to basically distract the nerves that send the message of pain to the brain, because our brain is really not good at multitasking, as we parents have probably now figured out. So I think it's a great tool, because we know that those same nerves that send the messages of pain are sending the messages of vibration and cooling. So why not distract using that? So I think it's a great tool for a lot of people, and can be used in conjunction with the numbing that we talked about earlier. But every person is different. And if you don't like it, if your kid doesn't like it, fine, that's okay. It doesn't mean it's bad for everyone, not for you. That's all right. Okay, so utilize comfort position. So what does that mean? So in the photo, you can see the child who's looking a little apprehensive is sitting in her mom's lap, and you can see the mom's face, which is one that's calm and kind of reassuring, like everything's going to be okay. Our children feed off of our energy, so we have to make sure that we have our own energy right before we can offer comfort to our children. Some kids don't like sitting in their parents', sorry, their parents' laps, and that's okay. We again have to listen to the child. What is it that they need? A lot of people tend to faint or feel lightheaded when they get these procedures. And what is that? So what's happening with that is, first, we're nervous, right? Most of us are nervous about getting any painful procedure, and our blood pressure is a little bit higher. And then we go into a kind of fight, flight, freeze response, and suddenly our blood pressure drops, and we lose tone in the blood vessels very quickly, and that's when we faint. And this, by the way, is genetic. So if you were a fainter, chances are your child may be a fainter too. So kind of be conscious of that. What are the things you can do to help with that? First of all, make sure you're well hydrated, drink plenty of water, and then using applied muscle tension exercises can be very helpful. So isometric exercises. So if, for example, you pull your arms apart for 7 seconds, hold, 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 and then relax for 7 seconds, repeat. Or remember the thigh master. I'm aging myself, I recognize, but you squeeze your knees together, hold it for 7 seconds, relax. So these exercises, repeat those, for about a minute before, and that will increase the tone in your blood vessels so that you're not as likely to faint. On that fainting note, some people, if you're prone to fainting, it's nice to just lie down a lot of the time, because then the blood flow is automatically going back up to your brain, and it can be more comfortable. So find a position that works for the patient. I think having, if you're injecting at home, you're going to be there, but just having a calm presence around is always reassuring to anyone. So be there. Avoid restraining. So the research shows that, we all kind of, did this to our own children, right? We suffered through it ourselves at some point, where, a bunch of people would hold down the child and you just get it done with. But yes, that solves the problem in the moment, but that over the long term essentially creates PTSD, right? No one wants something happening to their body against their will, and that is really what kind of drives the phobia a lot. So we don't recommend restraining people anymore. So please try your best not to. What you can do is, going back to the comfort positions, you can have your child sitting in your lap facing you and kind of give a bear hug. And so in essence, that is restraining. But if your child is like, no, give them space and time. We have to have them have autonomy of their own bodies, because we want them to be able to engage with healthcare as an adult too. Okay, give us a tasty sweet treat. Of course, this is all going to depend on your health, your other health issues and things like that. But having something sweet right about a minute to 2 minutes right before the procedure, this is more theoretical and just something I believe, it kind of soothes the pain, right? It's kind of stimulates your opioid receptors a little bit, and so it can alleviate the pain that the person feels. So you can consider using something like that. And then finally, distraction. This goes back to the fact that our brains can't really do two things at once very well. And so if the child is able to do something active, like play a video game rather than watch a movie, so actively playing a video game can be helpful. Just something that is engaging and using more of their brain than whatever else is happening can be very helpful. So let's go on to after. We kind of tend to ignore the after part. It's like, oh, it's over, thank God. Okay, we're moving on. But it's important to celebrate that moment, right? You, the person who had, as I talked about in the beginning, like you as the caregiver feel really bad doing this, right? Like you don't want to do this. And sometimes our reactions to that can be really, really different. Like sometimes it shows up as impatience with our kid. Sometimes it shows up as just like pure sadness. But congratulate yourself that you guys got through it, and also congratulate the child, because it's not easy. Even if you're doing it every day, every single day is a victory. So take that time to celebrate in whatever way you want to. And what that does is it teaches your brain that, hey, we can do this. This was manageable, and we're going to do it again tomorrow or whenever it is. And then, what we've also launched is our recover patch, which is actually a plant-based adhesive patch that you put on after the injection. And it utilizes turmeric and arnica to alleviate the bruising, soreness, and swelling. We don't really talk about this, the treatment after enough, in my opinion. But I think the thing that we all need to remember is that pain is a teacher, right? Pain tells us to move away from whatever that stimulus was. And so a lot of us, as adults especially, we can kind of use our higher functioning minds to be like, well, this thing is good for me. I'm going to suffer through this so that I get this positive result later. But our humanness, like our, natural instinct is to move away from a painful stimulus. So that's why we treat the pain, right? That's why we have anesthesia with surgery, and that's why we use pain medications and things after surgery. So it's the same way. We've got to do the same thing with even these smaller pains like needle procedures. I think, let's see. Just there's so much more. I could go on forever, but I want to make sure we have time for questions. And so on our website, we have some guides that kind of go through some of the things that you can do to make injections easier. We've built an app that kind of puts together a lot of the research back techniques to lessen needle pain and fear, and it kind of goes through the before, during, and after. So definitely reach out if you're interested. In something like that. You can follow us on Instagram. And then, some kids, some people, it's really important to not just limit this to kids, because this is a universal problem, have such severe phobia that some of these tools are not going to be enough, and that's okay. What the research shows is for severe needle phobia, things like basically exposure therapy, which and combined with cognitive behavioral therapy, can be very effective for reversing the phobia. And so we've partnered with Therapy Lab, who offers basically problem-focused therapy. So you can say, I have needle phobia, I want help with this. And it's very focused and it's finite. So it's not like you'll have to keep going on for forever, for years and years and years. You know what you're going in for, and you're going to get help solving for it. And then if you have kids, we all, or adults, again, I love children's books personally, and I get a lot from them myself. So two really great ones are The Little Ouch and The Difference Between Needles and Noodles. We all need to feel seen and understood, and just reading about another kid's experience is powerful. I think we've probably all seen that in, reading novels and things like that. You just feel understood on a different level, and you know that you're not alone. Speaking of that, we want to just get the word out there that this is This is so common. This is so normal. And we don't have to feel shame for being afraid of needles at all. And we can all share solutions that we've found for ourselves. And so, if anyone wants to share their own story in any form, in a poem, in a narrative form, in a comic strip, whatever, we would love to share it on our blog if you would like the space. So email us anytime if we can help. It's team@thimblehealth.com. And I think that is it. Questions?
Okay, we had a few questions in the chat. Let me take a look. Okay, so the first one was from Courtney. I gave my son his first injection yesterday with a nurse here. He has a fear of needles, and we had to hold him down. What should we have done to keep that from happening since it escalated so fast? And what do I do now that he's going to be even more stressed about next time?
Yeah, that's okay. So feel no guilt. We've all done it and everything is surmountable. So that's number one. Give yourself grace. Give everyone grace in the whole situation because everyone had a job to do and you got through it. But now I think it's probably a great opportunity to talk about it with your son and make that will allow him to feel really empowered, I think, in the situation. Might he have some fear? Sure. That's okay, but you listening to him and asking him to come up with solutions together, I think is going to be powerful. And I know I hope that answers the questions, but I think it's just as simple as that. Like we all can change course. That's it. We can always change course and try different things. And you can ask him what he didn't like about it, what he did. I mean, and then find out, was it the pain? Was it seeing it? Was it being held down? What can we do better next time? And then hopefully go from there.
I was going to say, I know for us, it helped us prepping the needle outside the room so they didn't see it getting ready and then coming in and being fast while she's being distracted. Distraction is good. But yeah, I think once they get it in their mind, then yeah, it kind of can snowball and get worse. So I don't know, for my kids, we gave them, I just said we wouldn't do it till she was ready. And sometimes that was 30 minutes, sometimes that was 5 minutes. And eventually we started using a reward chart to encourage it to be shorter because otherwise we'd be in there all night. But we didn't skip, even if it took till 10 p.m. We just started earlier. So I think that's what, being consistent, but letting them pick the time or be ready, or maybe they prep the pen, all helped.
I love all
And the
of
next one it says, oh, sorry.
No, I just love all of that. That's brilliant. Rewards, that's a good one. Every kid is different, so rewards work for some and they don't for others. But yeah, that's great.
Yeah, we did it with two, and it really depended. They had to be something they wanted. One of them wanted a sleepover with her friends, or to go to the mall, and the other one wanted a toy. So they have to want it. And the next question was, this is a struggle for us too. He's needed blood draws 1 to 3 times a year since he was born. It takes two blood tests, plus my husband and I, to hold him down. I want to be there for him, but I no longer want to be part of holding him down. So what could you do about that for like
Yeah,
a blood draw?
it's really hard. It's so hard. I think I just have a feeling it's not betrayal. I think that's the first thing is for you to recognize it. It's not betrayal. You're trying to help your child, right? And so even you knowing that inside of yourself is the first step because it's going to change the energy that you have with your child when you go in for the blood draw. And then I would encourage the same thing. I mean, I have a feeling that he might have really severe needle phobia. And if he does, do not be afraid to get help on that front. Oh, and I really have to shout out child life specialists. Oh my goodness, what a resource. Like if and not everyone has access, which is the problem, but if you can get some help and guidance from child life specialists, especially if you're going in for blood draws and it's episodic like this. Like if you can get someone in there to help you, that would be amazing. And then, yeah, I hope that you can find it in yourself to know that you are doing something wonderful for your son, and you being there is probably going to be the thing that helps him the most, and then probably may not need to be held down, I hope, coming up. And then I see the next question, which is like, who would the prescription
Prescription for the pain patches be? I was gonna say we did end up using the Emla cream for the blood draws, and I think it did help a lot. It takes them a while to trust it because they don't think that it was gonna help. We did some practice ones. We would put it on and leave it 40 to 60 minutes, and then like let her poke herself with, the tine of a fork or something, so she felt that she couldn't feel it. And then that really helped over time. But yeah, it is an instant. But yeah, so the next question was, who would you see for the pain cream or patches? Is it endocrine or dermatology?
Good question. You can see endocrine. You don't need to get an appointment with a dermatologist. Your primary care doctor, like really, any physician should be able to prescribe. But I would say it's probably going to be easiest from primary care or endocrine since you're going to be seeing them anyway. I also just wanted to mention just about the numbing solutions. I think it's really important. This is where honesty, I think, comes back into play. Like I think it's really important to not overpromise because everyone's pain is very different. And, something I always talk about is pain is not just physical, it's emotional, it's psychological. If you're in a bad mood, it's going to hurt more. That's just the reality. And if it's something that you want to do, like you see, people will get Botox all day long, fillers all day, no problem, right? Why? Because you're choosing that and it's for you and you it makes you feel better and you want it, right? That psychology, right, is like so important. But again, like somebody else is making you do this blood draw, you're not going to be happy about it and it's going to hurt more. Back to the honesty thing, I think just saying this is going to help you. I can't promise you that you're not going to feel anything, but I know that this is going to make it better is I think that's language enough alone is helpful so that they don't feel betrayed when maybe they do feel something or maybe, I think that helps.
Yeah, I think it's also time. A lot of people say that the numbing cream, they put it on only 10 or 15 minutes early, and it isn't enough. So I think that's part of it, is that often it wasn't let on long enough.
Totally.
Okay, the next one was, what are the adhesives on the patch that you were talking about? Allergic to adhesives like Band-Aids and medical tape. I mean, I know my daughter has medical devices that attach to her, and some of them she reacts to and some she doesn't. So.
Yes, this is a great question. So it does have adhesive, and if you're allergic to Band-Aids, I probably wouldn't use our patches. It's an acrylic adhesive in both of the patches, and so people will, some people will have allergy to it. The good news is you can try it, and if you do develop an allergy, you can simply, use some topical steroid to alleviate the itching, and then it's not a long-term issue. But I'm glad you brought that up because it is, some people are going to have trouble with it. And if Band-Aids aren't for you, probably neither are patches.
We have some allergies to some of it, so I think it's worth trying it. You never know. People who have to, we've been allergic to other things and not then one device that worked fine, so worth trying.
Good point.
Sounds like this one may be for me. What age was it when you could let them pick a ready time? He's four with big phobia. At four, they may just not be ready. We did it at six, and at nine, that's when my girl started. But I think that, I mean, maybe pick a ready time and they count down. Or something else that they're, ready at four. Honestly, some people do it in their sleep. As the kid agrees, and they don't, often they'll want to. They're like, yeah, I don't want it to happen, So I don't think it's betrayal there, because they're like agreed that it was, do you want us to try it in your sleep? And sometimes they move, but usually the next morning they do not remember it. Like, people say the kids wake up and they're like, I didn't even, did you do my shot yet? And they're like, yeah, we did. So. The next one, our 7-year-old has daily injections. It took 6 months for her to sit still on her own, even seeing a child life therapist and trying the tricks. It's pure needle anxiety, not pain. We're back to her needing gentle restraint to sit still again. Is cognitive therapy a good next step? The behavioral therapy that you mentioned.
I think so. I think so. I used it. I had to go that route with one of my daughters actually, and it was great. I mean, it is so hard, you guys. It is so hard. And don't be afraid to ask for help. I think so. And if you can, try to find someone who specializes in phobias, because it's exposure therapy also. I'm not an expert in this, so I don't want to misrepresent, but it's about like slowly building up comfort. And so oftentimes it'll start with like a picture of a needle and then it'll be holding a toy syringe and then it'll be holding a real syringe. And then, it kind of graduates like that. So I think if you can, yes.
There's also a good book called Growing Up Brave, which suggests bravery ladders, which are pretty much the desensitization you're talking about. And they have reward points where you start by, thinking about it and then drawing a picture of it and then look at it far away and then closer. So that book helped for us too. I think that was the end of our questions. One of the questions, I know that Courtney had some questions that maybe people had sent in advance, but one of my question was, how do you feel about like the numbing sprays versus the cream versus anything, I've just seen people burn themselves with the sprays, so they make me a little nervous, but is that a good option also?
Yeah, I mean, everyone is different, but in general, the sprays aren't going to work as well as the creams, and you need to leave the creams on long enough. That's really the key. And that's the hurdle, right? Like a lot of people, how can you prepare for 2 hours in advance? I mean, it's hard. But in general, the sprays aren't going to work as well. The sprays, however, if you don't have time, they typically feel cool on the skin. And as we talked about earlier, the cold is. The same nerves that send the message of pain also sense cold. So, that cold blast itself might be helpful if you have no time to do something else. But in that case, there are other cooling sprays that you can use instead that don't even have the drug in it. That might be another option, or plain old ice.
There's another question. Did you use a different numbing technique for shots versus blood work?
Good question. And the answer is no. So you can use the same. If you have Imla, use it for all of the above. If you have our patches, use them for any of the above. There's really no evidence that using Nummy, for example, changes vaccine uptake, for example, or like how well a vaccine works. So there's no reason, in my view, unless you have allergies or you're worried about the side effects, to treat the pain of any needle injection.
Yeah, obviously we did the cream for the shots and the Emla cream for both. We just put it on more and longer for the blood draw. Like we cut personally, we covered hers with a Band-Aid on her leg. It was just like a maybe like a a quarter to a third inch blob, as you said, blob for the for a blood for a regular injection that she gets every day with a sub-Q needle. We do more for an IM injection because those are bigger and deeper and longer. And for a blood draw, we probably put on like a section that big on both arms because you never know which one they're going to pick. And those we covered with those Band-Aids that are like this size. I know people do Saran wrap, but I got kids with sensory issues. So we had an ouchless, Curad ouchless Band-Aid because sometimes the Band-Aid adhesive is more of the pain than than the actual shot. So for us, we did use different amounts and different amounts of time. But we found 45 to 60 minutes was okay for daily shots. And we just set an alarm downstairs and then we do it before she, headed upstairs to do the shot. So we'd do it at a certain time. And then we'd know that, as soon as we got upstairs for the bedtime routine, the skin was ready and we could just wipe it off with an alcohol wipe and do the shot. The
Awesome.
next question was, is over-the-counter numbing cream as good as prescription?
Good question. Prescription's going to work better. So the Emla is going to work better. We actually did some studies comparing the drug kind of delivery through the skin, and so that's why it's a prescription. It's stronger. So it's going to work more effectively.
Yeah,
But
the one we had was, I was
let's
going to
go.
say, the one we had was 2.5% prilosec, 2.5% lidocaine, which is the prescription one. The only things I've seen over the counter are like up to 4% lidocaine. And I assume there's two different ones in there because they work better. And it's a higher percentage, 4-5% versus 4% of anything I've seen over the counter.
Yeah, exactly. So the one that she was referring to is called Emla. So if you go into your doctors, you can ask about Emla, EMLA. And yes, that second anesthetic does increase the efficacy. There are also side effects that you have to consider because of that second anesthetic. But yeah, that's why it works better. Still takes a long time, but it is effective. But the over-the-counter things are better than nothing. I think the reality is these over-the-counter numbing creams, you'll find them in the arthritis aisle. And these drugs were meant to be kind of left on the skin for 8 to 12 hours for long-term pain relief. And that's why we developed what we did. Like our intention is different. We're specifically designed and formulated for needle procedures. So that's kind of what the difference is, but we have to use what's available to us. So yeah. OTC is. Oh, one thing I wanted to mention, like the Band-Aid thing. The reason why saran wrap works better, the band-aid has a little absorbent pad in the center, and it actually sucks the medicine up, and you want the medicine to go into the skin. So that's why we recommend saran wrap or tegaderm. Or if you have to use a band-aid, what you can do is just like put a little plastic wrap over the adhesive part so that it's still going in into the skin.
Okay, next question. Does using ice 30 minutes every night cause skin damage if we're rotating injection sites?
I think it's fine. I think it depends on the age of the kid. Really, really, babies using ice in that way can cause damage. Is it irreversible? No, but it can injure the skin. An older child, it's not a problem, but also listen to them, because if it's, we all know what leaving ice on the skin too long feels like, and it's painful. And so once you get to that point, take it away.
Yeah, for us, I don't think we did try to do ice, and I think 30 minutes was too long. I think 10 was more the sweet spot. Some people did said that they would do it with a popsicle or an otter pop. They would put the otter pop on or popsicle on the skin for 5 to 10 minutes and then eat it while doing the shot, like you're saying with the sweet, to distract during the actual shot. So that was something they tried.
That's brilliant. I love it.
We did try Buzzy. I don't know if anybody else has tried Buzzy. We were not organized enough to keep the ice packs keep getting frozen. They would forget and they would get left out, especially since we did the shot upstairs and the fridge is downstairs, we did try it with just the vibration, and we didn't find it as effective as the numbing cream. But as I said, when she had to do the Lupron shots, which is a deep IM shot where they have to slowly inject it and it hurts more, that the optimal numbing was the numbing cream on 45 to 60 minutes and Buzzy. So, if you're saying you could do both, we found like for the bigger shots that hurt more that both of them was better. Okay. I don't know if we had any other questions. Have you ha seen any research about the other ones? There's like something called Tickle Flex and then Shot Blocker. I think they're also supposed to be kind of the distracting the nerves thing.
I don't know about Tickle Flex. I'm gonna have to look that one up, but Shot Blocker, it usually have one hanging around, but basically it's like a it has a lot of prongs on it, like plastic prongs. And so you kind of press it into the skin, and then there's a little kind of opening where the shot is going to be given through. And yeah, some people find it really helpful, and other people find it scary because it looks like a lot of prongs. But that's what it's doing. It's basically like causing a small amount of pain all around the site that you're going to be doing the injection, pressure and pain. And so yes, it's distracting the nerves in the same way. But I've had a lot of people say that it really helped them. So if you're it's worth a try, I think. And the nice thing about that is you can reuse it too. So
Yeah, I think, and it's cheaper than the Buzzy. Buzzy, when we got it years ago, it was like 30 or 40 bucks, but I think they're now up to 60. So I always say this, I think it's like $4 or $5 for Shot Blocker. So it's probably the cheaper. I mean, ice is the cheapest option. And I don't
Yes.
even want to think how much money we've spent on copays for numbing cream over the last decade. But it does work. I also think there's a point where it's psychological, not just pain. And that they feel like they're in control of it doing these things. So that those things help, even if it's not actually that painful anymore. Even if I didn't leave the cream on, like sometimes we forget and don't leave the cream on quite long enough, she still doesn't, complain because she has an expectation that it's helping. And, we did the stuff that's supposed to help. So I don't know.
No, it's I feel like that's the biggest takeaway, is like the psychology is really, really, really important. And I don't know, somebody else gave the example of like if you're playing sports or whatever, and someone kicks you in the shin, you keep going. Like it's like you just because you don't feel it, your motivation is different or whatever. And but if someone just had you restrain and then someone kicked you in the shin, it would feel a lot different, you know? So yeah, it's a good point you bring up.
Are there any other questions? So where are your patches available? Are they already out or are there new ones or?
The recover patch, which is the post-procedure patch that you put on right after the injection, is available on our website. It's thimblehealth.com. And actually, we're HSA FSA eligible because our whole goal is so that hopefully eventually everyone has access. And one thing I would say is like, we need people to talk about this problem more vocally because Nothing changes in healthcare unless we people on the ground start shouting for change, you know? And so we need to let our hospital systems know, our insurers know that like we need these solutions. They're going to help us. They're going to help us get all the healthcare that we need to stay healthy. So that is that. So recover patch available online. Prepare patch, which is the one for before to numb the skin, is going to be out in June, knocking on the wood in front of me. So yeah, and that should be HSA, FSA eligible as well. So we hope.
It'll be purchased from your website, or long term, I'm going to get them in like Walgreens or.
Yeah, right now on our website, and maybe available in some other retail. We're considering going onto Amazon and things like that. And what our real intention is we want people to be getting it from their systems. So we're trying to make the B2B situation happen as well. So we'll see one step at a time. And if I think what we need to do is prove that people really want these solutions. I think, the people on the industry side of things are like, is that really an issue? Is that a problem? But that's why I think it's important that we talk about it more, so people will know we would like solutions.
Yeah, optimally, that would be amazing. Like with my daughter's injections, they send us 30 needles, but they offer to send 30 alcohol pads and 30 band-aids. But if they could send us 30 of the prepare patches as part of it,
Yeah.
that would be the optimal thing long term if it's included, with the shots when they come. That would be great.
Brian.
Thank you very much. Did you have any other comments or anything you wanted to add?
No, just thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. I knew it. I just learned so much from you. Thank you. I love the popsicle idea. No, I just appreciate the opportunity and any advice, feedback is always welcome because you guys, like I said, you're living it. You know a lot more than most of us do. So appreciate it.
Thanks for your time. We appreciate you showing up for us.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much for your time.